What's up, everybody? We got another
episode of Undefeated Magazine. Noah Rock the Boat Robinson's right here. I got the head honcho, the director of so many world-class boxers. He got his hand in a lot. He's a man of great, great integrity. And I personally know him. So, there you go. But anyway, here's Mr. Willie Savannah. How you doing, Chief?
Oh, pretty good. Just getting ready to start the road, trying to get another one or two world champions.
I see that, man. Who's a standout you think you got for this Thursday's fight card?
Well, Juan Capato, who's fighting the main event in this fight. He's a junior welterweight, and I think he's got a chance to go all the way. And he's the main one right now because Damazo couldn't fight because of his hand. But right now, it looks like it's going to be Capato.
Yeah. What weight class? He's 140, right?
Yeah, 140, junior welterweight.
Okay. Now, also, how do you feel over Mr. Baby Bull Juan Diaz's retirement? Because you had a hand in everything he did, everything. So what is your, honestly, can you talk to the fans and let them know, you know, how you feel about it? Do you feel like it was right on time for his retirement? Was it too soon? Just your thoughts.
Well, actually, I thought it was right on time. I thought he should have retired, and I told him that too. He's lost the last four out of six fights, and I just think that unless some major changes was made, he definitely needed to retire, and he did it, and I'm happy for him.
Okay, that's good. Now you got a whole new stable of fighters coming up. Is it just the three you named, or the one you named with Juan, or do you feel like you got some more in the stable
ready?
Well,
you know, we got 200 kids over here. We got probably about 150 registered boxers. Mm-hmm. These are boxers that's registered that can go fight amateur at any given time. I'm sure we have more registered boxers than any gym in the United States. So out of that whole bunch, we've got several. But, you know, the drawback is having qualified coaches to work with them. Because there's no way are you going to get a coach that came through the program to come back and give to the program, even though someone gave these guys. I mean, I've been in this thing for 31 years, and I don't have one person, except Hanato Alakon, that came through my program that's willing to come back and give back some of the stuff that they received from someone else. You see what I'm saying? And this is the worst thing about boxing, not just in my gym, but all over the country. These guys, they get out and they won't work unless they make $2. If you can't give them $2, they're not going to help a kid. And that's just the bottom line, you know. And you can come over here in the gym and you can see the trainers around here in the mornings. And then you come back in the evening, you won't see those guys no more. They're too elite to work with kids, and I think that's a disgrace myself.
So pretty much, in their mind, they're too elite to work with kids.
They think they're too elite. But see, one thing about it, and I learned a long time ago, when I started off on Martin Luther King, February of 1980, I started out with Ronnie Shields and several other, Eddie Green, Freddie the Pebble Jackson, Anthony Wildcat Wilder. We started out with elite fighters. I didn't know the first thing about boxing. But we had about 35 amateurs. And then Ronnie and several of them turned pro. And the next thing I know, my trainers in the gym was only working with the professional fighters. Mm. They wouldn't work with the amateur kids. And I'd get on their butts about it, and they'd say, oh, yes, we do this every day. Now, I'm sitting right there looking, okay? Okay. I'm sitting right there watching them every day.
Every day. I know you be watching.
Yeah, and the kids telling me, Mr. Savannah, they won't work with us. Oh, yes, we do. That's what the coaches said. We work with them. So next thing you know, I said, we don't have any. We got down to where we did not have one amateur no more because the elite coaches that was training these professional fighters would not work with those kids. And I tried to tell them, you do not allow your crop to deteriorate. You got to keep playing the seeds. But the elite trainers always believe that guys like me and other amateur gym are going to automatically give them ready-made fighters. You see? And I've made my mind up that I'd rather have a wino training my fighters than to keep giving my fighters away to guys that will not participate in the growth of these kids. You know what I'm saying? I'd rather get a wino under the bridge to help me. That's just the way I feel about it because, you know, we got every evening at least 100 kids in here. You will not see one of these world-class trainers, elite trainers, come in here and say, son, keep your left hand up. Well, they said, well, Savannah give them to us anyway when they get ripe. Bullshit.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Mrs. Savannah. Is there anything else you'd like to tell the folks about any of your fighters, anything else about your boxing gym? You want to give address, anything like that?
Yeah, matter of fact, you know, I begin now to get back into putting on amateur shows. We had an amateur show here 2 weeks ago on the 23rd. And we had, I mean, we had 39 fights. Okay.
Wow. That's Golden Glove-ish almost.
Yeah. And the month before, we had 33 fights. And, you know, I used to put on a lot of fights when I was on South Post Oak. Every Friday, the first Friday of each month was Savannah Big Kids Boxing Show. So now I see the interest really has come back, and I'm getting a little bit more motivated by putting more fights on. So right now, I've filled out sanction forms to put on about 5 more before the end of the year is over with. And, you know, we give a lot of trophies, and we try to treat the people right. So a lot of people come to our shows. So, and, you know, we draw as much amateur shows as some of the pro shows draw. And I just might even start putting some small caliber pro shows on here.
Why not?
Yeah, that's right. You know? because, you know, like, we have, like, last year, we had over 800 registered boxers. Mm-hmm. 2-3 years ago, we had 500. So, you know, the amateur program is growing leaps and bounds. Mm-hmm. Now, we've got a kid that's fighting today in the jails down in Mobile, Alabama, mm-hmm. named Roberto Tomas. And he's down there with my coach, Renato Alacon. And he's fighting on the 11:30 time zone, 11:30 bouts. And he's got bout number 9. He's fighting a kid from Wichita, Kansas. So we hope that Robert do well. Regis Prigos, he lost in the Olympic trials yesterday. So he's out of it now. So, but again, you know, Regis and a lot of these guys out here, when they're getting ready for these big fights, you won't have experienced coaches working with them. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, and that's a big thing. But when Kronk was in power, Kronk had all of those coaches that was helping. But I can't get these guys here to do anything. They're too lazy. You know, they just won't get up off their ass and do shit. Unless if you pay them $2, I guarantee they'd be here an hour in advance. You know what I mean?
Oh, man.
Uh-huh. And it's crazy. Here they got one of the nicest gyms in the world. Mm-hmm. They got more fighters than any gym in the world. Mm-hmm. Well, I'm too lazy. I'm not gonna do that. What can you give me to work with that little 9-year-old kid? They ain't gonna work with no 9-year-old kid. You crazy?
That's sad.
That's sad. It's a sad situation.
That's sad.
You come over here in the evening sometime and see if you see one of the elite trainers from the mornings come over here in the evening. They ain't got a damn thing to do but sit around on their ass at the evening and say yes, ma'am, and no, ma'am to their wives or whatever, girlfriends, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Hell, they ought to want something to do. I get up at 5:30 every morning. I go to the wellness center to work out. I leave there, and I come here for about 10 o'clock. I leave here about 1:30. I go home for about 2 hours and take care of some paperwork. And I'm back here at 4:30, 5 o'clock in the evening, and I get out here at 10 o'clock at night.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Now, you would think some of them old guys that came up through my program years ago would feel sorry for me. Come over here and help out, would you?
Yeah.
I'm over here emptying trash cans and shit, you know, filling up water bottles, cleaning machines and shit at 10 o'clock at night. And I'm walking like Fred Sanford. And these bastards won't come over here and help do shit. The only one that'll help out is Renato and Tim Knight.
Okay.
The rest of these bastards won't do shit.
All right, Mr. Savannah, you want to give any of the future up-and-coming boxers your address just because they're looking for a gym?
Oh my God, we got some men. I don't know if we can handle it. But anyway, the gym for the up and coming amateur, we are open 4 p.m. to 8 p.m. Monday through Thursday, and we go to boxing shows on Saturdays, and whatever else we do. But it's 6909 Ashcroft, ASHCROFT, zip 77081. That's right off the corner of Ashcroft and Bel Air, across the street from Fiesta.
Okay, one last thing, Mr. Savannah. You want to give a shout-out to Undefeated Magazine?
Oh, of course. You know, I think Undefeated Magazine is really doing a great job because there's nobody else that was writing about the boxing until Rosemary came along and got you guys all involved and everything with Mike and everybody. I think it's great myself because everywhere you go, you're going to see Undefeated Magazine somewhere, you know. And I got lucky when I was on South Post Oak. We had Channel 45. Used to come out and cover us all the time when Juan Diaz was coming up, you know. Mm-hmm. And I remember when Juan was back 13 or 14 years old, we had three TV stations. We had Channel 45, Channel 2, Channel 11. Mm-hmm. Out there with their trucks, with the big antennas up in the air, mm-hmm. doing their live sports show from my amateur's gym.
Yeah.
They were wanted to, Juan in the ring in the background.
Mm-hmm.
So I had to, they asked me, could we start the fight 5 minutes late? So I told our association, I said, we need to take a five-minute break because they want Juan in the background. Blah, blah, blah. They grumble like hell. And what these idiots don't understand is that what's good for my gym is good for all gyms.
Right.
You know, and we always got the coverage. We always, you know, way back when, you know. And but they don't understand it's not just about Savannah. It's about the amateur boxing. If the Hispanic newspaper, the Chronicle, who did a story on the thing here last week, Channel 45 comes over here once a month, and single out two or three kids to interview to have on their shows, you know. So if that's good for Savannah, it's got to be good for amateur boxing.
That's right.
You know, but these kids, but a lot of these coaches are jealous, and they think it's just for Savannah.
Mm-hmm.
And if they talk, well, look, when Muhammad Ali used to fight. On a Saturday night, every gym in the United States was full of new recruits on Monday morning. They all wanted to be like Muhammad Ali. You see what I'm saying?
Yes,
so what people, you know, when they talk about Juan Diaz over here, how he came up from age 8 and accomplished all of the things that he did, that's good for my gym and it's good for all of the gyms. Not just, I guarantee you, probably because of Juan Diaz, maybe 200 or 300 more kids are boxing in our association that would have boxed because every one of them want to be the next Juan Diaz.
That's right.
Okay?
That's right.
And I tell them, everyone, the little fat dude coming here, I said, you the next Juan Diaz, man. Juan was 8 years old, weighed 110 pounds. I got a 10-year-old right now coming here, he weighed 220 pounds. Yeah. Yeah. He 220. He comes to me every day and hugs me. I can't get my arms all the way around him though. You know, I miss him. And his name is Juan. Then I got another little old fat Juan.
That's what's up. That's what's up.
Oh man! And they come in, they hug on me. I give them cookies and all kinds.
Okay. We gotta cut this. All right, there y'all go, man. The interview with Mr. Savannah, First Thing Willie, was truly, truly, I don't even have any words to put it into. It was a lot of valuable information out there, a lot of truth, a lot of honesty. Like I told you, he's a man of great integrity, and he don't hold his tongue for nobody. So that's another episode of Undefeated. Y'all go to Facebook, Undefeated Magazine / Undefeated TV /